Srimati Isawanda Lalu is the Deputy Commissioner of East Khasi Hills District since 2020. A resident of Shillong, she studied English literature before joining the civil services in 2013. She has been posted in different districts of Meghalaya before her current posting. I now hand it over to you, Ma'am Isawanda.
Thank you so much. Good evening to everyone. I hope everyone's having a good time. It's been a series of stimulating, rigorous, and engaging talks, and I'm so excited now to have with me Ms. Shreyana Bhattacharya, author of Desperately Seeking Shahrukh, India's Lonely Young Women and the Search for Intimacy and Independence. She's already been introduced. Welcome to Shillong, Shreyana, and I hope you're having a good time. Shreyana, as has been mentioned by in the introduction remarks, is an economist, a development and policy person. She's a researcher, a writer, and a Shahrukh fan. So all these things come together so beautifully and remarkably in this wonderful book, which in its essence is a narrative weaving together the stories of different women across socioeconomic strata, different socioeconomic strata in the country, their journey into SRK fandom, and how the icon of Shah Rukh Khan has defined their experiences in some way or the other. I would like to mention that the book has received numerous accolades since it was released in the month of November last year. It's been a year. It was awarded the Times of India Nonfiction Author Prize, the Scotch Best Economic Writing Prize. It was shortlisted for the Best First Nonfiction Tata Lit Live Prize from Mumbai, and is also shortlisted for the Atta Galata Prize. Congratulations, Shreyana. And we're all looking forward to hearing from you. So before I invite you to read a little from your book, I'd like to ask you, why Shahrukh? What is the allure? What is the reason behind this book?
So Isa, this is such a pleasure, and I just want to thank Mary again for inviting me to the festival, and this has just been such a wonderful day of sessions. I've learned a lot. Before I answer why Shahrukh, I think it's important to understand why this book, because I think the book and the research ties into Shahrukh. The book starts in 2006. I was in my early 20s. I'd been trained in a very mechanical way of doing economics. How many people here are students of economics or have studied economics? You just raise your hands. Okay, so the ones who are raising their hands will have a sense of what I'm speaking of, which is there's a hubris in economics to try and really collapse really complex phenomena into statistics, right? And I was trained in that. I thought I was very good in it. And I was sent to a slum in Ahmedabad, in an area called Bapu Nagar, where I was part of a project with the Self-Employed Women's Association, which is one of the world's largest labor unions for women in the informal economy. And I was supposed to administer a very simple questionnaire on their working conditions, wages, just, you know, try and understand. Most of these women in this particular neighborhood were home-based garment workers, home-based incense stick makers, earning about a quarter of minimum wage. And when I showed up with my questionnaire and I started going through it, they looked incredibly bored. And I'm good at picking up boredom, so it's a bit dark now, but if I see anyone's faces here which are bored, I'll stop as well, or you should stop me. And I'm so attuned to boredom, Isa, that I decided that this traditional approach was not going to work. And in the social sciences, they teach you, you know, you use icebreakers when conversations aren't going very well. So I started asking everyone about their favorite actor. And everywhere I went, from the slums of Ahmedabad, when I used the same technique in the forests of Jharkhand, rural Uttar Pradesh, everywhere I met Shah Rukh Khan fans, and everywhere I heard this one common refrain, and across these different localities that I have followed these women through, which is, you know, men are like Salman, but we would prefer Shah Rukh. And when I started to probe what that meant, it took me 15 years. So I encounter a set of 8 women. I followed their lives, their economic trajectories, their personal lives for more than a decade, and the book is a result of that. It's their lives. Why Shahrukh? I think three reasons. Why Shahrukh in the book was because I was very interested in telling a story about women's lack of purchasing power. I don't know how many of us know this here, but India right now ranks in the bottom five in the world when it comes to women's economic freedoms. The state that we are in right now, Meghalaya, reports around 44% employment rates for women, which is actually in the top three of the country. The highest is Himachal Pradesh, followed by Sikkim, and then it's here. And but most of the country, and certainly most of the regions that I follow, are below 20%. Barely women are able to hold on to paid jobs and earn an independent income. And how that relates to Shahrukh is actually most of the women, when I started asking them about him, they would tell me how much they struggled to just be able to watch his films. They didn't have money, they didn't have purchasing power, they just didn't have access to media, they didn't have their own mobile phones. And it became this very interesting way to talk about women's compromised access to markets, to money, and to media. So that's one. And the other part, which is, you know, the Salman Shahrukh refrain, is that, you know, I have a line in the book, and I believe this, which is that as men in reality just disappoint women, Shahrukh Khan just grows exalted because, you know, he's not real. And I think part of it is the sheer dissatisfaction that so many of these women, Issa, from, you know, cross-caste, cross-class, there's really a cross-section of women in the book, but there is a deep dissatisfaction in the way gender norms, particularly in the mating market, in marriages and love affairs, are playing out. And I think he's an escape from that, and a counterfoil to a very different kind of masculinity. So I'll constantly hear women tell me, well, you know, he's in the kitchen. And they'll say, I've never seen an actor, you know, peeling a carrot before he did that in DDLJ, unless he was playing a chef in the film. You know, he's racing helicopters, and the next minute he's sort of, you know, helping someone pick a sari, right? And he goes on Simi Garewal and he says, there's a lot of woman in me. And I think it's this different kind of masculine that's really, it seems to be an antidote to this very suffocating masculinity that so many of the women in the book describe. So I think why Shahrukh? I mean, one, of course, I love him, but I think my love for him has been burnished through the period of this 15-year research. But why him? Because he tells us a lot about women's access, as I said, to economic freedom, to personal freedom, and to this really parochial idea of what a man should be, which I think so many of the women in the book are just rebelling against.
That's wonderful. Shiana, I'd like to invite you to share with the audience from your book.
I'm actually going to keep it very brief. I'm going to read from essentially what is, I think it's towards the conclusion, where I'm trying to summarize what I've learned, and I think here we go. For much of my adult life as a working professional, I thought I was collecting stories about how women see Shahrukh Khan and his films. In fact, I was collecting narratives of how they saw themselves and those around them. Because none of us know Shahrukh, and none of us hope to. Fantasies are not meant to be tarnished by reality. We made him up, and he happily participated in the myth we had created. In imagining Shahrukh, the women I encountered tried to imagine an alternative to the masculine worlds they occupied. They forged out of the gossamer fabric of their hopes and dreams a man who would support freedom and choice for women, whether to work, rest, or watch movies. This imaginary world with its teary-eyed men who wholeheartedly love women with wide open arms and soppy wide open arms may not be radical, but it is a challenge to the world we currently occupy in which so many women feel unappreciated, unsafe, and unloved.
Beautiful. Thank you, Shiana, for that. In that sense, you know, the book is both about Shahrukh then and also not about Shahrukh, but especially in that, you know, the paragraph you just read, in a sense, Shahrukh has been, or the myth of Shahrukh has been created by the women who watched him. And he means his appeal is different for each one of them. In the book, you outline that. Vidya likes that he's a self-made man, goal that he's so devoted. You know, so can you spell out a little bit more about that?
You know, I realized, and that each time I'd have these conversations with so many of the women I was privileged to follow and talk to repeatedly, is that none of them were actually describing the same person. I mean, when they talked about this actor, and I really hope, the one thing I hope that the book does, and I feel like it's been a bit of a success, is that, you know, this very glib way we talk about celebrities that almost everyone, you know, so I was always told that Shah Rukh Khan is an urban celebrity who's for NRIs largely. And then I discovered this was not true at all. In rural Uttar Pradesh, there's a woman I follow. She absolutely loves him simply because to her, he is the urbane ideal of a man that she cannot access in her real life. And he works in the kitchen. She sort of combines the two. But you're right, Isa, which is that I think the way so many of these women construct Shah Rukh for themselves is very class dependent and obviously depends on geography. So for example, there's an IIT engineer in the book, upper caste, very posh, English speaking. She loves him because to her, he represents a man who made it on his own. That's really the one thing about him that she absolutely adores. She says, you know, he doesn't come from networks. She's a first generation migrant who's moved from Tamil Nadu to Delhi. Struggling because her parents can't really make a phone call and help her out, you know, with the job that she wants or with a school application or an Ivy League application that she would like to make. And I think given that she feels she doesn't have adequate network wealth, she looks at him and she says, well, this is, you know, sort of the man that I think has made it and this is the kind of success I would like. The other interesting thing about her, which I also notice is true for many elite English speaking and middle class fans as well, is that nobody really watches the films anymore. In fact, the reason why they absolutely love him is because it's of his interviews. And if you realize, he's actually one of the first stars, you know, we say he's a post-liberalization superstar. One of the major things that that means is actually he was accessible to us on television in a way stars before him never were, because there just weren't that many TV channels around. He came around the time satellite reform happened, telecom reform happened. And so I think for the middle class and the elite, he's very much a story of social mobility, what it means. You know, many women will tell me, I discovered the phrase middle class because of him. And I now understand what it means based on what he used to keep describing in his interviews of being middle class. So that's one. Then you move down the chain in the sort of second section of the book, which is this emerging middle class. So these are women typically who are the first in their families to study beyond schooling, first to actually have a job of their own. For one of the women I follow, who is a government officer from the Delhi government, she says, you know, each time she's doing well in her job, her parents keep making her, and her parents and her immediate social milieu keeps making her feel bad about the fact that she's not doing well in the marriage market. So she keeps saying, well, you know, I'm doing well in the job market. Why is this tyranny of marriage just constantly being thrown at me? And Shah Rukh for her is just release. She watches Om Shanti Om and dances to his songs anytime she feels really sad about the fact that her parents will just not engage with her success, will not acknowledge her success, are unwilling to even talk to her about what her job entails, whereas her male cousins are always indulged. Shah Rukh is almost, you know, I describe him and she, I mean, I realize she kept a scrapbook of his different quotes from interviews about how to do well in your career. And, you know, he's definitely one of those people who's given lots of conversations and speeches about, you know, dealing with career anxiety and professionalism and all of these things. He's her self-help guru. He's a self-help coach. He's not an actor for her. He's someone else. And then, Isa, if you move towards the latter part of the book, which is very much women from the precariat. So these are women, you know, the ones I started with in 2006, barely earning minimum wage. For them, he is this beautiful man, this beautiful dream, but he is also the announcement of liberalization, the fact that now girls can leave their village, go to a city, and perhaps meet a man or have casual sex with a man who looks like him, like that idea of possibility. He really definitely represents that for many of the women. And the other thing he represents, which is really critical, is domestic labor for them. The fact that, you know, you have a man who sort of, it participates in the kitchen. But what's common, Isa, and I'll end on this, in fact, cross-class for all these women, and I think it speaks to the emotional and economic impoverishment of women just at large, writ large in our country, is that each one would tell me, well, have you noticed he speaks to women? He acknowledges their psychological state. He's actually interested. And I measured talk time, dialogue time that women have in his films relative to, say, the big Hindi film hits of, you know, other male superstars. And unsurprisingly, women just speak far more because there's an actual dialogue and communication going on between him, be it the girlfriend, the mother, the sister. I mean, you know, women are just constantly speaking. Even in the films where he's playing fairly, you know, what we would call regressive roles, even where he's a stalker, women are speaking and they're present, as opposed to, you know, other films where even if they're about feminist issues, like I'm thinking of a film like Pink, Amitabh Bachchan will just speak throughout the entire film, right? He'll give us constantly lectures about one thing or the other. So that's one. I think the fact that, you know, he performs emotional labor. And the other is, and this one is tricky given that some of his earlier characters were stalkers and were doing fairly terrible things to women, physically and psychologically as well, is that despite that, and I think here it is a combination of the songs, because remember many of the women who are low income from the precariat, they're not watching the full films, and you'll have to read the book to understand. The fact that you can watch a film at the age of 25 on your own is a privilege accorded to a very small minority of our country. And I think that's something, I mean, there's data in the book, you'll have a sense of that, especially as a woman. And so for most of them, they're actually just watching the songs. So they see him touch the heroine a certain way in those songs. Everybody keeps telling me, have you noticed he always goes for the neck, which apparently Indian men don't do. I don't know what's going on in Shillong, but apparently, at least everywhere I went, this was something everyone was complaining about. Nobody is paying attention to the neck. Closer to the chicken neck, I'm not sure what happens here. But but what I will say, though, is that, so there's this idea that there's a man who acknowledges a woman's body and sees it in a certain way, and he's sexy. I mean, I think that's something that, and everyone has, you know, their own language of describing it, and I won't give it away. You have to read the book to see, because, you know, the sexiness as an idiom is actually new by the time he comes in, and so different women describe it in different ways. So I think that's largely the appeal. But you're right, it is very different, but I think sexiness, emotional labor, and a kind of interaction with the female body is very different from many heroes of the past.
I love the emotional labor part, because I remember, I mean, repeatedly you talk in your book about the Khan triad, right? And Salman is known for being shirtless. Amir is the perfectionist, hero. While Shah Rukh is the only one who cries and emotionally bears all, and that has struck a chord, I think, with so many women. So Shanna, you were talking about, you know, how women from different life situations and, you know, have encountered him in a different way. But the running thread across your book is that for each of these women, despite, irrespective of their class or education or, you know, status in society, have turned to a screen icon for emotional fulfillment because of some distressing situation in their particular context. What do you think does that say about the larger, larger Indian society as a whole, particularly with regards to how women can express themselves and how they can lead fulfilling lives?
So, you know, I've been saying this a lot, which is, apparently we're an independent country, but I think women are still fighting their personal independence struggles, each one of us. And I think our society has very insidious ways. I think even in the previous panel, and I think so many of the conversations today, we've touched upon this. Economists have this very, you know, because economists have elegant language to things. So we call these things taxes. And I describe this in the book. There's actually work that economists do that shows that when people start behaving in ways that social scripts are not comfortable with, they're not conforming to tradition, we impose what we call hidden taxes. And these are not taxes in rupees or in dollars, but these are taxes in feelings. So you make people, you know, so women are trained in self-doubt, right? And you see the sort of, I give you some sense of that based on these 15 years of conversations about how hard it is to just regain a sense of confidence, where you can claim that you have a favorite actor or you want a job and you want to just do something on your own. And so I think what it speaks to is the sort of personal independence struggle that different women are facing. But having said that, I am also very tired of this kind of language around gender norms. And I think someone in the morning today was talking about specificity. Each one of us has a very different set of constraints, privileges, you know, just the social fabric that we're occupying. And my hope with the book, in fact, is, you know, often I notice that when we talk about women's issues, you get the Nykaa version of the women's issue, which is we have this big CEO, or we look at wonderful officers like you and like people who've achieved a lot in life, and we'll say, well, isn't it great we have all these women achievers, you know, sports persons or so on. And then you have stories of victims, right? So you have the victims of patriarchy, people, you know, who faced brutal crimes. Both, of course, you know, we should be talking about them, but I think my book is largely about a lot of women, what I call the missing middle of the narrative. It's all these women in the middle. They're struggling. They're struggling in very casual, everyday ways. They're struggling to find self-confidence. They're struggling to just watch their favorite actor. They're struggling to hold on to a job. They're struggling to just find a boyfriend who will, you know, emotionally honor them. And these are not things I realize that can, they're not protests out on the streets, but I describe this in the book. These are private rebellions, and they're happening in everyone's homes. And they're so important. And if there's one thing feminist literature teaches us, is that it's actually these really small private rebellions between intimate partners, with, you know, conversations which are really hideously difficult. And I know fiction does a really beautiful job of sometimes bringing them to life, but I think I was privileged through the process of this research to have access to this in that nonfiction reportage form, these really horrible, difficult conversations with fathers, boyfriends, partners, husbands, about what would it take for gender norms to change. And the one thing you'll take away from the book is that all these women, over the 15 years that I've known them, and I'm in there as well, I speak and I say this about myself, I think each one of us has been able to negotiate a much more fulfilling equilibrium. And so the second last chapter is called, I talk about an equilibrium of silly expectations. Because the idea, you know, when you go into a gender studies class and you tell people, someone's idea of being a fulfilled woman is to just be able to watch the actor that she likes at will. I've been laughed at when I mention this in like very traditional, stuffy social science classrooms, but this is actually what the texture of everyday life is. It is not up to everyone. You know, just like what we were saying earlier about, you know, fashion could be a form of feminist resistance. Watching Shah Rukh Khan is feminist resistance for a woman who does not have the time to herself, because all the data from India shows we're in the bottom five of the world when it comes to men helping in housework. Bottom five. And in that world where women are supposed to just constantly be stuck in that care role, to take that time out, to earn your own money, to just want to watch your own actor, it sounds really silly. But you realize, and my hope is through the book, you realize how poignant and powerful just that very simple act is. And it makes me hopeful for a future.
That's wonderful. Thank you. So, yep, please, hand of applause. I think we'll take questions. So I invite members of the audience to put forward your questions to Shanna. Mike, please.
Shayana, I'm dying to read your book now. I'm going to ask you a very kitty party type question. I just want to know, you know, in terms of, because even for me, you know, Shah Rukh Khan was one of the first movies, Hindi movies that I watched, because Doordarshan and, you know, the Star TV and everything. And of course, I fell in love with him, etc. But that love and relationship with Shah Rukh Khan has changed over these years. And one very important aspect of my relationship with Shah Rukh Khan is actually Gauri Khan, and how she's become a very sort of independent woman in her own right, and how what that says about Shah Rukh Khan as a husband. So I was just, you know, wondering, you know, in during your research, you know, if not just his sort of fictional characters, but, you know, the actual man, husband, and, you know, how Gauri Khan sort of figures in the way women think of him.
Should we take a few, or shall we? Okay. So I actually want to start by saying the reason the book actually reached Mannat, and I reached Mannat, I believe it's someone from his wife's family who read the book, told him, and then I think it was through all of that that happened. So I'm very, so she actually, she's played a role, despite I've never met her and any of that. But in the book, there's constant reference. So, you know, when we were talking about how so many middle-class English-speaking women largely, I think that's something that is true, would watch him, because his interviews often he was speaking in English. He would mix Hindi and English, but it's largely it was an English idiom. He would talk about the woman in him, and then he would just talk about his mother, who raised him as a single parent for a very significant period of her life, and he would talk about his wife. And you'll see it across the board, particularly women who are born in the, say, late 1980s onwards, who saw all of that at a fairly young, impressionable age. You know, you were just going into college or thinking about studying, entering the market for mates and trying to find a partner. You saw all those, and it stayed with you. And there's a quote by someone who says, you know, she says to me, she says, you know, this is a dream because I bet, you know, she's not really that happy in real life. And then, but what's fascinating is everybody wants to buy into that dream because the reality is perhaps very complicated, full of bargains. And so everyone needs that escape. So they look at that. So she does come up through the conversations when you read it, more in the idea of how he celebrates his wife and their role together. There's a lot said about infidelity in the book. Because one of the things I actually describe this in the book, which is that everybody keeps, you know, the media for a while used to report on him as if he was the poster child of marital monogamy. And there's a fabulous television episode, which I mention in the book, where Tavleen Singh follows him around for a day. He's shooting for a film called Duplicate. And when she does the show, she actually says this, and this is on, you know, fairly conservative satellite TV back in the day. She says, oh, you know, in an industry where having a girlfriend along with a wife is considered a status symbol, he's so unusual because, you know, he doesn't. And that keeps coming up in conversations again and again. So yes, I think that idea of being this supportive partner and also this fetishization of a certain kind of monogamy and the way it was talked about in the media, that does come up quite a lot.
Can we have more questions? Someone at the back, yeah, on the left. We can't see you, so perhaps you can come a little more to the light. It's not working. Do you want to come here?
It's fine. It's come. Thank you. For me too, Shah Rukh Khan was one of the first actors I saw out of the genre of Dharminder and Amitabh Bachchan and things like that. I wanted to know that since the person the women in the book whom you've interviewed have all spoken of his film persona, what did they feel about the surrogacy? Because that's such a intensely emotional problem for so many middle-class women about fertility and the patriarchal nature of pressure on women, where he had two children and then this couple who were much older decided to go in for surrogacy. Did any of the women discuss that or talk about it? Did you bring it up?
No, not at all. And in fact, a couple of things. One is, you'll see in the book, in fact, the class character of the women I follow is such, there's only about two upper caste women in the book, me and Vidya, who we were talking about. And I think, in fact, the idea of marriage, motherhood, one of the things you realize, I mean, when you follow the stories, is how much of a given those sort of markers of life are, right? So the conversation around surrogacy, and remember the book, I follow these women from 2006 till or about 2019. No one brings up, I mean, people talk about his happy family, but nobody brings it up. And one of the rules I had as, and this I think was a research practice of mine, I abhor this kind of deeply intrusive set of questions that you ask people who tell me about your personal life and tell me about this. One of the things actually you'll notice is we only talk about his films and his interviews, anything that's in the public domain. And what's fascinating, of course, I realize as a research method is if you actually talk to people about their pleasures, they'll open up so much more than if you actually went and only wanted to talk to them about their deprivations and poverty. And so I never brought up surrogacy from that perspective because that's really not the business of his, you know, the icon of like the interviews that are out there, the songs and the movies. Motherhood does come up more from an economic perspective because India has one of the highest what we call motherhood penalties in the world. Motherhood just kicks women out completely of the paid workforce. And 64% of women's labors in India are unpaid and a large chunk of that is nurture, right? That keeps coming up a lot. But no, not on surrogacy. It felt too private and it would be intrusive, and that's something that I really didn't want to do because I never talked to them about what was going on in his life in that sense. And I must also confess that one of the things I also realized is, for example, the news of the surrogacy, and you'll sense it when you read the book and the people in the book, many people didn't even know. I mean, these kinds of things operate in a certain environment, in a bubble. We should also recognize that. We think everyone has access to it, but actually a lot of people weren't even aware.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we have very little time left, but I just have two quick questions for you. Shania, as author of one of the most superbly feminist texts I've read in the last year or so, I just want to ask you, you know, through the course of this conversation, what has emerged is really the picture of a Shah Rukh who's very self-aware. He's self-deprecating. He's humble to a fault. He's a superstar. He's a billionaire, and yet he's fashioned this persona which appeals to women both on screen and off screen. Do you think a woman can ever aspire and attain that kind of celebrityhood today?
Yeah. I think they have. I think there are several. In fact, I say this in the book, so many of the women, the younger women I follow, when I say these women are desperately seeking Shah Rukh, they are not seeking a celebrity or celebrity gossip about him. They are seeking the money to watch him and they are seeking the love that he has and the confidence that he has. They don't want to marry a Shah Rukh, they want to be him. And in fact, many of the women in the book, they claim that they have become him because they have their own income and they don't need to rely on other person's network to do well. To them, that is what that means, being Shah Rukh. And I do say this in the book, which is I think the Shah Rukhs of the future are all women. I mean, they're all the big actresses, sportswomen. I think women will lead the charge right from the Nykas of the world to the sportswomen that we celebrate. So yeah, and you are a Shah Rukh as well, using that idiom.
Thank you. And to end it off, on a fangirl note, did you get your fangirl moment and did you get to meet Shah Rukh Khan? And tell us about that.
Yeah, listen, so fortunately the book that's here is the paperback. He wrote a note for me, so I did meet him and I just described I have his wife to thank. Not directly, but indirectly to thank for it. And his manager, Pooja. He wrote a note for the book, and one of the things that was actually amazing is he fully understood that it was not about him, which was really heartwarming because his name and face are on the cover, and yet he fully understood that he was a research anchor to actually talk about women's lives and the sort of contemporary patriarchal setup, how sophisticated patriarchy has become. And he enjoyed that. And he appreciated the fact that the book was, and I'm quoting him, he said, a heartwarming and entertaining way to learn about the economics of things. And he's a student of economics, so that appealed to him. And I always say this, you know, people say you should never meet your heroes, but if Shah Rukh Khan is your hero, please meet him. He will not disappoint.
It's a beautiful note to end on. Thank you so much, Shania.
Thank you
beautiful.
So much, Isa.
Copies of the book are available. Please get your signed copy from the author herself. Thank you so much. Congratulations. It was lovely having you. Thank you.